everybody. So good to be with you. Thank you so much for joining us this morning here. What an absolutely beautiful day, isn't it? It's amazing out there today. So I want to encourage you to grab a Bible if you don't have one. You can find one underneath one of the seats in front of you. If you want to have a Bible beyond this morning, we would invite you to just go to the back area, the guest information counter after the service. We do have Bibles there. We'd be happy to give you a complimentary copy that you can have to take home with you as well, so that you do have a copy of God's Word with you. But I want to invite you to turn that open. If you do use a Bible under the chair, just I believe it's on page 1014. So 1014, it's the book of 1 Peter. I don't know if you heard about this a number of years ago, but in June 23rd, 2018, you may recall the story of a soccer team. They call them football team, but it was a soccer team, a group of kids, 12 kids in fact, ages 11 to 16, and their 25-year-old assistant coach. They entered into a cave system in northern Thailand. I don't know if you recall that story, but it was quite something. And shortly after they entered into that system, heavy rainfall began to pound the area, and it ended up flooding the cave system, and those kids and that assistant coach were trapped deep within the cave system. Efforts were made, of course, to locate the kids, but they could not reach them for about a week. Nobody had any idea in terms of what condition they would be in, even if any of them would be alive. If you were to see sort of the cave on a map, the way they showed it, it was just, they were 2.5 miles in from the entrance of the cave, and it was just like going like this through it. It wasn't sort of straight in. It was just absolutely treacherous to try to even get in there. How they got in there initially is quite amazing, but it all filled up with water. There was no way that they could leave. So a massive, actually global rescue effort was put forward to take these, to get these kids out of that cave. And on July 2nd, after advancing through all these narrow passages, divers from Britain, actually, British team of divers, were able to find the group alive. They were sitting on an elevated rock roughly 2.5 miles away. But then they had to figure out, how do we get these people out of here? How do we make this escape? You see, because the divers had to go in and they had to crawl through these extremely tight spaces with all of their diving gear on, and it's such a distance in, and it was all muddy water. They could barely see anything in front of them. They had to feel their way through. Well, after days, of course, of pumping water, because that's what they had to do, pump water from the cave system, they did have some reprieve from the rain that had been pounding. Rescue teams did work everything they could to try to rescue the kids out of the situation. It was estimated that they had about 10,000 people involved, 100 divers, scores of rescue workers, representatives from about 100 government agencies, 900 police officers, 2,000 soldiers, 10 police helicopters, 7 ambulances, and more than 700 diving cylinders, and the pumping of more than 1 billion liters of water from the caves. And then 18 days later, after all of that, all 12 boys and their coach were rescued from the cave. One diver didn't make it, and one died a year later. So two suffered as a result. Now, how did they do this, though? How did they do this? How did they actually get them out of the cave? Because finding them was one thing, but how did they get them out? Well, if you've seen the movie, it's called 13 Lives. It's a story. It's a true story. And the movie's based upon that. It's a great story, a great movie to watch. You see in the movie that the plan was to do this, and they didn't tell this to everybody, but to get down there, and how do you get people that have never been diving before out? I mean, these are like the world's top divers were called to this rescue operation. So how do you get them out? So finally, one of the divers, who is also a medical professional, who was an anesthesiologist, came up with the idea that we're going to sedate them. So as they got down there, one by one, they just sort of quietly just distracted the kid and then jabbed him in the arm. He went under sedation, and then they, one by one, strapped the kid to the diver with a tank of oxygen, and the diver had to very carefully go all the way through from the beginning or the end all the way 2.5 miles, and it is quite a tale to watch that whole thing unfold. In many respects, when you watch this, you think this is truly an amazing miracle that takes place, that these kids actually survived this, but they were under sedation, and many of them, if they would have been conscious, probably would never have made it. They would have panicked. Well, as you can imagine, as each kid was brought safely to the cave opening, you can imagine all the people that would be waiting for them, right? All of the parents that would be there, the loved ones waiting and hoping and praying. And if it was my kid, as selfish as it sounds, you would probably do the same thing. You'd probably be hoping the kid coming out is your kid, right? That it's your kid. And when the families see their sedated son dragged out of the cave, there is this eruption of emotion, tears and joy and celebration because their son was rescued or he was saved from death in a watery tomb. An amazing story indeed. When I think about that story and I think about our text today, I can't help but think of the rescue that we've received. We are actually the recipients. If you're a follower of Jesus, you're the recipient of a far greater rescue than even that. As amazing as that is, something far more significant, far greater, that puts that sort of in pale in comparison. Peter tells us this in the first chapter, in verses 3 through 12. He tells us that as followers of Jesus, we too have been rescued. We have been saved. We've experienced salvation, not from something that's physical or something that's temporal, but rather something that is eternal, the salvation of our souls, that we've been rescued, we've been delivered from our own sin. That salvation is described for us by the Apostle Peter in those verses here in verses 3 through 12 that I want to read to you this morning. So if you have your Bibles open, or I think we'd have it on the screen for you, Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you in the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look." This passage here, in my view, as I look at this text, the overarching message of this text is about the greatness of the salvation that we've been given. I want you to notice, before we dive into this, just to take a glance over the text if you have your Bibles open. I want you to notice how often this subject comes up for Peter. Right here in verse 3, he talks about being born again. That has to do with salvation, okay? He talks about in verse 5 how there's a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In verse 7, he talks about the revelation of Jesus Christ, that is, his second coming. You see in verse 9 that he talks about how you are obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. In verse 10, he says, concerning this salvation, all through this whole section, Peter is saying to us about the greatness of the salvation that we have received. What I want to do this morning with you is I want to walk you through this text, and I want to begin by by starting where Peter starts in verse 3, because I want you to notice the first thing he says that drives, I believe, everything else he has to say about salvation in this passage. I want you to notice how he begins. Take a look at verse 3. He says these words, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." That's Peter's starting point. The word blessed, or the word praise. Praise be to God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, that's the starting point. For Peter, he is moved to praise. He offers up blessing to God because he's about to tell you about the salvation that he himself knows dearly. He's about to tell you and I, as well as readers now 2,000 years later, about the salvation that is ours. And when we hear about the salvation that is ours, what God has done for us in Christ, this should naturally well up within us, if we have salvation, great joy. It should create in us praise be to God for what he has done. You see, just like those parents who had those children rescued from that watery tomb, potentially, they offered up such joy and jubilation and just hearts filled with gratitude, a mixture of just weeping and sorrow, but immediately turned to great joy that they saw their son, who they thought might be dead, is now alive. So too, in even far greater way, when we see what we've been rescued from, should have within us this heart swell to say, praise be to God. Lord, I'm grateful for all that you've done for me. You see, that's what drives Peter's message here. That's his starting point. And what I want to do now in the remainder of this message, and if you were given your notes to the sermon when you came in, I want to walk you through, in verses 3 through 12, the five reasons that Peter gives for us to praise God concerning our salvation. Five things that I want to pull out of this passage for you. So here we go. Number one, first of all, we have a reason to praise because our salvation is caused by God. Our salvation is caused by God. Again, look at verse 3 with me. He said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again." He's caused us to be born again. Now, there are two very important things in this text that I think are noteworthy for us to look at. Notice he talks about that our salvation is according to his great mercy. That's the first thing. When we think about mercy, we think about not receiving that which we deserve, right? Mercy is not getting what you deserve. And we think about our own condition from a Bible perspective, what the Bible teaches, what is it that we actually deserve? As fallen, sinful creatures in this world, God doesn't owe us absolutely anything. In fact, what we actually deserve is punishment for sin, for rebellion and disobedience against God. That's what Scripture teaches. And yet God, in his mercy, he chose not to give us that. Instead, he chose to give us salvation, right? He suspends his judgment and his wrath because of what Jesus Christ has done and gave us mercy. His mercy. Notice we didn't do any of that, did we? We didn't get the mercy ourselves. We didn't create that. It was given to us by God. In the same way, he says in this passage, not only did this happen because of his great mercy, but he, that is the Father, caused us to be born again. He caused this. This is, again, uniquely the work of God in our lives. Now, we have four children in our home, and so of these four children, none of them intentionally thought to themselves, of course this is going to sound silly to you, "Today is the day that I want to be conceived." They had no concept of that, did they? No conscious awareness. They didn't even exist, actually, did they? Nor did they think when they were in the womb that today is the day, a conscious thought, today is the day that I am going to be born. Now, when the time is right, the child will be born. But the child in the womb is not consciously thinking, you know what? I'm going to be born. This is when I'm going to do it. And they may want it to be another time, but I am going to make sure that that doesn't happen. That's not how it works, is it? That's not how it works. They don't decide on our own to make a grand entrance into the world because they've consciously said, I'm going to make this happen. We had nothing to do, if you think about it, with our first birth in that sense. And we have nothing to do with our rebirth either. Being conceived and being born into this world was not our idea. We did not cause that to happen. And that's what Peter here in this passage tells us as well. Peter tells us that he, that is God the Father, has caused us to be born again. We are passive, in other words, in this. In fact, the original text here even tells us, indicates to us, that this is a passive thing on our part. God is the one who's took the action. We're passive in this. You could think of this even like the 12 kids who were rescued. How were they rescued? They were sedated. No, they weren't dead. They were sedated, but they were passive in this, weren't they? They were put in a condition where they had no knowledge that they were being moved through this extremely treacherous terrain to safety. They were passive. So we too were passive in that we're the recipients of God's decision to give us mercy. We're passive in the sense that we are recipients of God's choice and decision to cause us to be born again. You know, the Bible tells us, if you think about this in sort of biblical language, that our condition before we accept Jesus Christ is one of being dead in sin. Ephesians 2, verse 1. We are spiritually dead. And the last time I checked, physically dead people do not respond at all. If they do, run. Spiritually dead people, some people might say, well, yeah, you respond. Well, the Bible would beg to differ. The Bible would say that we are born in sin, that we are spiritually dead, that we, if you're dead, you're dead. If you're dead, you're dead. I remember a number of years ago reading the account sort of this, of kind of describing the comparison between the way people think about this subject, and they refer to it as if there's sort of a man that's out in the ocean somewhere, and he's flailing away in the ocean. He's drowning. He's in the process of drowning. And he's just, arms are up there, and he's moving around. A helicopter comes in to rescue that individual, and they throw down the rope with that life preserver thing on it, and he reaches for it. He grabs it. They pull him up to safety, and he's rescued. And people describe kind of, that's what it's like when you become a Christian, you see. You're out in the ocean of this world, and you're struggling in life, and you're, you know, help me, help me, help me. And they throw down the preserver, and you grab onto it, and you're rescued, you're pulled to safety. I would suggest to you that that's actually not the correct picture biblically. The correct picture biblically is that, yeah, you and I, before we come to know Jesus and experience salvation, we are out in the water, there's no doubt about that, but we're not on the top, we're not on the surface, we're not flailing about, we're not even asking in many respects to be rescued. Why? Because we actually have taken in all the water into our lungs. We've sunk to the roots of the mountains and the bottom of the ocean floor. We are dead. Dead, friends. The helicopter comes along, they know where we are, they send a diver down. And the diver picks up your corpse from the bottom of the ocean floor and brings you up, and somehow that corpse has to come to life again. You see, that's a more accurate analogy and picture. But we like to have this idea that we're sort of one participants in this, we're sort of actively doing this, but the reality is this text tells us that it was according to God's mercy and that actually God is the one who caused you to be born again. You see, it's thinking about this, about born again. Oftentimes when people think about being born again, you think about John chapter 3, maybe you think about Jesus and his conversation with Nicodemus, and people will say things like this, well, in order to be born again, you have to believe in Jesus, and then you will be born again. The word born again is used by Jesus in John 3. It's used by Peter here in 1 Peter chapter 1, and he tells us that God caused it. And you think about it, well, we don't bring about our first birth. We don't really bring about our second birth. Who brings that about? It's God who brings the spiritual birth about. He's the one who's the author of it. We don't bring it about because we're spiritually dead. We can't do anything to actually bring about our spiritual rebirth. So what has to happen? What happens is, in the words of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, we see that God took us out of our spiritual condition and God made us alive. When you think about being born again, here's how I would encourage you to think about it. That you are born again, and then once you're born again, you respond to God with faith and repentance. Not the other way around. You don't have faith and repentance, and then you get born again. You are born again by a miracle of God. God gives you his mercy. He causes you to be born again. This is about spiritual rebirth, spiritual renewal. We use the theological word regeneration to describe that. When you are regenerated, it is only at that point in time, and it's at that exact moment, that you can actually say, Jesus, I need you, I believe in you, come into my life. Because we don't have the capacity to do that beforehand. Now, that may be a radically new way of thinking about that for some of you. Maybe you've never kind of looked at that way before. But I would encourage you to kind of just explore that, if that's new to you, to think about that. You see, Peter is wanting to make sure that God gets the glory for salvation completely and 100%. That he wants you and I to see that there is so much reason to praise. We had nothing, absolutely nothing to do with our salvation in that sense. Certainly, once God causes us to be born again, our only thing is that we respond now to him, and we now are enabled actually to respond to him in faith. So that's the first reason to praise, because salvation is caused by God. Secondly, we have a reason to praise because our salvation brings hope. Notice again in verse 3 what Peter says. He said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, he's caused us to be born again to a living hope." To a living hope. A living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. When we are born again, then, it is, notice, to a living hope. It's once you're born again, you are given a hope that is anchored in and rooted in the fact that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, and that means the hope that you and I have is that someday we too will experience that same resurrection. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Apostle Paul put it this way, starting in verse 16, he said, "For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins, then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied." In other words, Paul is saying, listen, the fact of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the reality that he was raised to life, he is victorious over sin. He's victorious over the grave. He is the risen, ruling, conquering Savior and King of Kings. If he didn't rise from the dead, your hope would be sort of empty and it would be in vain. It would simply be in this life. Why would you bother doing that? That's the end of the story and move on. But our hope here, Peter tells us, is actually not in this life only. Certainly, we get hope. Why? Because we know of that as the reality. Our hope is anchored in knowing that Jesus Christ was buried and raised to life. Our hope is in Jesus knowing that he's actually going to come back again. Our hope is in knowing that we are actually someday going to be with Christ. So our hope is in the reality that there is an afterlife and that there will be a resurrection for us. When you're standing over a grave of somebody who knew Jesus, you have the hope that you're going to see them again, that you'll be reunited. As heartbroken as you are, you have that hope that stands in front of you. You see, our present hope, the hope that we have now, the hope of eternity, is what actually enables us to persevere and endure. If we don't have hope, it's really hard to keep going, isn't it? This is why people become hopeless. But for followers of Jesus, we have a hope that's in front of us. It's not always immediately in front of us in the things of this world, but it's a hope that we look down the corridors into the future and we go, we know that there is a sure things, there is a certainty that's there, not a wishful thinking. Peter puts this living hope in contrast then, if you will, to a dead hope. Maybe a dead hope, the contrast of a living hope is this idea of wishful thinking. It's the idea that, you know, I wish this would happen, or I wish that would happen, or I hope I get that at Christmas, or I hope I get that at my birthday, or I hope that my wife doesn't leave me, or I hope that my job doesn't, I don't get fired from it. Those are all wishful thinking, aren't they? Our lives are full of wishful thinking. But this isn't about wishful thinking. This is about certainty. And in a world that's so uncertain, friends, boy, we could all use a little certainty, couldn't we? I mean, think about the world now. So many people are living in a state of hopelessness all around us, right in our own nation, right in our own communities. Oftentimes, hope gets propped up in this temporal world because we have the financial resources to sort of sustain and help us and make us feel comforted in this world. But the reality is all of that can get stripped away in a moment in our lives. People that today can't afford a home, they can't pay bills, they look at their retirement and don't know if they'll ever be able to retire. They look at the world and all the problems. They look around at our own country and they wonder where we're headed. They look at sort of the political scene and they wonder, Lord, are there others who could run for president of the United States? Like, people are struggling today with understanding this, right? The fears that people have, violence that they see, hatred towards other people because you disagree with them, confusion, rampant confusion over identity. People are searching. They're broken. They're lost. Brokenness in homes, brokenness in marriages, families that are ripped apart for all kinds of reasons. You look at all that scene. If you don't have this hope in front of you, the certainty of hope, then what do? You spiral easily into hopelessness. This is why people end up killing themselves, isn't it? Because they reach a point that life is not worth it. But the reality is that it is worth living, right? Because there's hope. There's a living hope. But you see, friends, this is our message, isn't it? It's a message of living hope. It's about salvation, that salvation in Jesus Christ gives you and I this living hope. When all of the world around us seems to fall apart, we have this as a sure thing in front of us. A hope that comes when we find that in Jesus there is meaningful, purposeful, valuable existence. That life is precious to God, and that actually God sees you as precious and valuable, of great worth to Him. And then thirdly, what Peter does is he tells us that we have a reason to praise because our salvation includes an inheritance. Notice this in verse 4 and 5. Again, Peter says in verse 3 that we've been born again. He's caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Verse 4, to an inheritance. So when you're born again, when you receive salvation, you are given a living hope, and you're also given an inheritance. And then he describes that inheritance with these three words. He says, an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Did you know that you have an inheritance? Not an inheritance here on earth, but a heavenly inheritance. An inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. It's kept for you in heaven. Now, my kids, I trust, are going to be sad when we die. I'm sure they will be. But they won't be disappointed when it comes to an inheritance because they know that they don't have one. I mean, that's the reality for us at this point. You know, let them know that early. Listen, there's no need to fight over whatever the will would say because there's nothing really in there, guys. Now, we have very little by way of material things as a family, right? So, and I'm not telling you this to feel sorry for us. Please, I don't think it's a feel sorry thing. but we have very little by way of material things to leave the kids. So what do I have? I've got a whole bunch of books. Oh, yeah. I mean, who doesn't get excited about a whole bunch of books? I mean, thousands of dollars worth of books, like whatever, 10 bookshelves full of books. I mean, if somebody died and gave that to me, I would be in heaven, too. I'd be like, yes, although I'm finding I'm getting a little tired of moving books and putting them on shelves. People are like, have you ever heard of, like, digital libraries? I'm like, yes, yes, but I still believe in the hard copy. Still believe. Trina has a whole bunch of teacups. The kids will, well, Nathaniel won't enjoy that very much, but the girls probably will really enjoy that. And her, like, 6,000 Starbucks mugs that she has. Like, this is what we're going to bequeath to our children. I mean, how exciting. We actually don't own a home. We own one car. We have next to nothing in the bank. We're counting on our kids to take care of us when we're old. We've already told them. Our retirement plan is you guys. Like, get some education. Like, come on. Friends, we're looking for another inheritance, right? When you don't have all of that stuff, you're looking for another inheritance. You're looking for an eternal one. In fact, all of us should be looking for the eternal inheritance, shouldn't we? I'm not making a comment about any earthly inheritance. Wonderful if you've got that. I'm just simply saying that there's an inheritance that far outshines any sort of inheritance that we have on earth. I want you to connect this with Peter's readers, his audience. Just think about them. These group of churches from Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, Pontus, they're scattered, right? They're scattered. They're exiles in the land. In other words, they have no inheritance. There's no sort of like Jewish inheritance of land that they could cling to or anything like that. Their inheritance that they're being told of is not in this world. It's in glory. And friends, when you and I are scattered, when we feel like exiles in this world, we feel we're strangers, we don't fit and belong. Boy, that's what we do, isn't it? We anchor down in the truth of God's word to say, Lord, you have caused my salvation, Lord. You have given me a living hope, Lord, that I look to. Lord, you have given me an inheritance that's not of this world that I can look forward to. Thank you for the salvation. Reason to praise. Reason to praise. He says of our inheritance three things. He tells us, first of all, that our inheritance is lasting. Notice this in verse 4. He uses the word imperishable, undefiled, unfading. This is a lasting inheritance. Jesus even told us, didn't he, in Matthew 6, he said these words, to lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, not on earth, where moth and rust destroy. Our greatest treasure, you see, is not on earth. All those things are temporary. They're transitory. They are ruined, Jesus says, by moths. And all the shiny stuff just rusts in the end. They'll leave this over to some relative who comes along later who maybe we'll love it and enjoy it, but to what end ultimately is all of that, you see? Our true treasure is not found in things. Rather, it is found in a person, and his name is Jesus. That's the true treasure. So lay up for yourselves treasures not on earth where moth and rust destroy, but lay them up in heaven with Jesus where that lasting inheritance is. Secondly, he says our inheritance is in heaven. He just simply states it, that this inheritance is kept in heaven. That's where it is. Just in case you're wondering, that's where it is. You're not in heaven now. Don't expect it now. This is not the place of your best life now, right? It's in the future. This is when it's coming. It's something for us to look forward to. And then thirdly, he tells us our inheritance is secure. We have an incredibly secure inheritance. He says this in verse 4 and in verse 5. Again, notice what he says, how he puts this. He says that the inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Kept. See what he says there? It's kept in heaven for you. How? I mean, who's doing the keeping of this thing? God. Notice again in verse 5, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed. So this salvation, this inheritance, I should say, is kept in heaven. It's kept by God. That's the implication here. God is the one who's keeping the inheritance for you. If it was left up to me, maybe I might blow my inheritance. But God is the one who keeps it secure. And in verse 5, it's by God's power. You and I, by God's power, are being guarded. Notice how this is translated in the English. It's not by God's power are guarded. It is are being guarded. It is an ongoing present reality that he's ongoing, in an ongoing way, God's power is what's guarding us. Warren Wiersbe, he makes this interesting comment about these words that are used here. He said the word translated kept is a military word that means guarded or shielded. The tense of the verb reveals that we are constantly being guarded by God. Notice, again, we are, by God's power, are being guarded. And that assures us that we will safely arrive in heaven. The same word is used to describe the soldiers guarding Damascus when Paul made his escape. Believers are not kept by their own power, but by the power of God. Our faith in Christ has so united us to him that his power now guards us and guides us. We are not kept by our strength, but by his faithfulness. How long will he guard us? Until Jesus Christ returns, and we will share in the full revelation of his great salvation. I hope you see in this text so far how God should really get the glory in salvation and everything. I mean, this is again why Peter starts, praise be or blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because he's the one who is the cause of our salvation. It's his mercy. He caused us to be born again. He is the one who gave us this living hope. He is the one who gives us this inheritance. He is the one who keeps the inheritance and keeps you and me so that we will see the inheritance someday. The security that God gives us in this life while we go through this world. Reminds me in the Bible in Ephesians 4:30, for example, where the Apostle Paul says that you and I, that we have been sealed until the day of redemption. We are sealed with the Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit, when you come to know Jesus Christ, comes to live inside of you. You are indwelt by the Spirit of God. And when the Spirit of God lives in you, he does not depart from you. He stays within you. And you are sealed with the Spirit of God until the day of redemption. That is, until you go home to be with Jesus Christ. Then you no longer need to have the Spirit dwelling within you. The Spirit is the guarantee, the deposit, Scripture tells us, of the things that are to come. The Bible also tells us in John chapter 10, verse 28, that no one can snatch you from his hand, from the Father's hand. No one. And you hear people often say, yeah, but you could take yourself out of the Father's hand. Good luck with that. Okay? Good luck with that. Those who'd like to suggest that you can kind of just walk away from your salvation and lose it, so many people online today and Instagram talking about the deconstruction of their faith. I mean, this is going on like crazy nowadays. The reality of it is this. I remember walking with my son or with my daughters all the time, and as a father holding my kid's little hand, I mean, it didn't matter how much my kid let go of the grip. I had their hand. Nothing could snatch them out of my hand. You see, because their grip is weak and my grip is strong in comparison. And we think about the Father when he says that nothing can snatch you out of his hand. That means nothing can snatch you out of his hand. That includes you as well. And if you're really born again, you wouldn't want to be snatched out of his hand. You want to be snuggled up as close as you can to the Father. And you're so grateful that in times of weakness in your life that the Father still has you. He holds you fast. He's got your hand in the most difficult things of your life. That's the truth of God's word. Now, where in the world was I? Oh, yeah. Peter has told us here that God's caused us to be born again. He's given us a living hope. He's given us this inheritance and glory, and he'll guard and protect us through this life to ensure we get our inheritance from him. We have a great salvation given to us by God. And then fourth, we have a reason to praise because our salvation gives us perspective about trials. Now, Peter's writing this to a group of people that are enduring trials. They're going through all kinds of difficulties. They're not experiencing sort of the full range of persecution, for example, that comes later under Nero, where they're being put to death for their faith in Jesus. They're experiencing kind of on a spectrum, kind of the insult kind of portion of that, where it goes, as we said last week, from insult eventually to injury, where they're being martyred for their faith. But as they're being persecuted for their faith, they're being maligned, they're being misrepresented, they're being made fun of by the community around them as exiles living in a strange land. And in that, into that group, Peter says, I want to remind you about the great salvation that we have. And this salvation, when you think about this salvation, it gives us perspective about our trials. It helps us to sort of have a category for trials. Here's what he says in verses 6 through 9 about those trials. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him, or do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Peter begins this section, verse 6, with the words, in this you rejoice. In this you rejoice. In what does he, what's he getting at here? It's important to think about everything that he said up to this point in verses 3, 4, and 5. And he's telling them, in this you rejoice. In everything that I've just told you about salvation, that it's been caused by God. He's the one who caused you to be born again by his mercy. That you've been given a living hope, that you've been given this inheritance, and that that inheritance is protected and guarded by God to make sure that you receive it someday. It's all of that that causes Peter then to say, in this you rejoice. Like, you rejoice in knowing that as a follower of Jesus. It is this truth, all of that he's given to you in salvation, all the hope that you have that's in front of you, that helps you when you face trials. That's why he goes on to say, in this you rejoice, though now, for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials. Put the trials, in other words, in contrast with the glory that's to come. The trials are here, but there's something a whole lot better coming. I want you to notice again what he says in verse 8. So he tells them, in this you rejoice. In other words, you rejoice in all the salvation you have. When you think about trials, you put them in contrast. But also notice verse 8, though you have not seen him, he's talking about Jesus, you love him. Though you do not see him or now see him, you believe in him, rejoice with joy that's inexpressible and filled with glory. Why does Peter say that to this group? Because they have come into a relationship with Jesus Christ, and there they are dealing with those who are mistreating them, maligning them. And he can say to them, you rejoice in the salvation that's in front of you. And even though you haven't seen Jesus personally, you're going to see him someday. And you rejoice because of that. Because in the midst of all the trials, where are your eyes? Your eyes are on the prize. You rejoice with joy that's inexpressible and filled with glory, because someday at the revelation of Jesus Christ in verse 7, you will see him. Friends, that's what happens when you have salvation. Salvation helps us to put our trials in proper perspective. It doesn't make them easy. But it helps and remind us, doesn't it, that this is not all there is. Boy, if you didn't have any of that and you're just going through all the garbage of life, it'd be tough, wouldn't it? You didn't have that future hope. Peter tells us three things about those trials in this text. First of all, he tells us that our trials are momentary. Notice he says they're for a little while, a little while. Peter doesn't know when they're going to end. In fact, they do get worse for Christians in time. But his point is that this world is brief. This life is brief, isn't it? It's really for a little while, like mortality compared with eternity. It is for a little while. He then tells them that our trials are diverse. He says here, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials. Like, it's not just one type. It's not just one thing. It's many things. We all experience them. And then he tells them that the trials are purposeful, thirdly. Notice at verse 7. In verse 7, he specifically says that the trials have come so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. I know we've talked about this before, and I'm sure many of you have heard before. What Peter is doing here is how he's reminding the believers of the process of refining of gold. He's drawing a parallel between sort of the goldsmiths and the metal workers of that day who would take gold and they would melt it down with extreme heat to purge away from the gold all of the impurities, all of what they call the dross, to extract that all out of the metal so that all that's left is just pure gold, so that the goldsmith, the metal worker, could look in to what's there and see his reflection. And Peter's driving at that to say, in this season that you're in right now, that this little while, these trials that you're going through, this is the purposeful work of God who permits these trials, because like gold, he is taking you and he's allowing you, as churches scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, all the way 2,000 years later to you and to me, he's allowing the heat sometimes to be turned up in our lives so that the dross would be purged out of us, to God would refine us and take the impurities so that our maker, the one who shapes and forms us, he can look in and he can see his own reflection in us by making us more like him. That's what he's doing. You see, when you have salvation, you are given this perspective about trials that is so needed in our day. I would imagine every one of us this morning we have something in our lives, some sort of trial that we're dealing with. We might think when we hear about the suffering of people in other parts of the world that this is really petty and what do they call it, first world or whatever problems or whatever, right? And yes, when we compare ourselves, sure. But the reality is sometimes we still do feel those things pretty deeply. We have some hard trials we go through. I want to encourage you that in the midst of your trials, to make sure you understand and see that God is not done with you yet, and that God has purpose and meaning in your trials, and that those are for a little while. But God never promised in this world, did he, that your existence and mine would be free of trials. In fact, he said just the exact opposite, that in this world, you and I would have tribulation. But be of good cheer, take heart, because Jesus overcome the world, and so will you, and so will I. We have a life beyond this mortal existence. And that leads us, lastly, to the last and final reason to praise that Peter gives us. Number 5, our salvation was predicted in the Old Testament. He says in verses 10 through 12, he said, concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves but you and the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. What Peter's doing here is he's trying to encourage the church that the salvation that they've received, that salvation that was caused by God, that salvation that brought the living hope to them, that salvation that includes this inheritance, that salvation that gives them this new perspective about trials, that salvation, all of it is centered on Christ, and all of it was predicted and planned and anticipated by God from the very beginning. That through the prophets, he says, it was this salvation that the prophets who prophesied, Old Testament prophets, they prophesied in the Old Testament time period about the grace that was to be yours. Those prophets, when they received revelation from God and wrote it in Scripture, prophets like Isaiah, they would read Isaiah 53, or they'd write it and they would say, they would carefully search and inquire and say, what is this about? To whom does this refer? You see, they didn't necessarily have full knowledge and information at the time of receiving those revelations, did they? Sometimes they would, but other things would be future. They couldn't see clearly about them all. And Peter tells us that those prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours, they searched and inquired carefully. They wanted to know, verse 11, what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them, so the Spirit of Christ is in them when they're predicting the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glory. So these Old Testament prophets, occasionally in Scripture, they would predict long in advance, hundreds of years before Jesus was ever born, that the Messiah would come and he would suffer and he would die. But there would be glory that would follow. But you can imagine from their perspective, they're searching, they see these texts, but they're wondering, to whom exactly does this refer, and when exactly will these things actually come to pass? But notice the text tells us, in verse 12, it was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves. They realized what they've heard is not for their time period. It was for something in the future. And Peter says that they were serving not themselves, but you. You, church, the ones scattered in Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, you're the ones who've actually received the message of the good news. That message that was planned and purposed by God from all eternity was written about in Scripture. You have seen the fulfillment of that in the person of Jesus who came, who was born into this world, and who offered you this incredible salvation. You have a reason to praise because of that salvation, and you're the recipients of it. So Peter began this section with those words, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." His heart was full of praise when he considered the salvation that he had been given. And like Peter, our hearts have plenty of reason to praise this morning for the salvation we have in Jesus Christ. You and I today can make a choice, a joyful choice, to rejoice and to praise God because our salvation was caused by God, because our salvation has brought us living hope. It provides an inheritance for us. It helps us to have perspective about the trials that we endure in this world, and that salvation was predicted and planned by God. This wasn't sort of some happenstance thing. It was part of his divine plan from all eternity. So friends, when the waters rise in your life, when the fires spread, when the wind blows, and when foundations around you may be feeling like they're crumbling, when the roof might feel like it's caving in, remember that these are all for a little while. And set your hope fully on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. He is coming back. You've received his salvation when you were born again. He's keeping you in salvation, constantly guarding you so that you'll receive the inheritance. And this text promises us that his revelation of his coming, he will be back. And you will make it safely home. And you will be with him in glory. So take heart and be encouraged because of this great salvation. Let's pray. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you praise. Lord, you are so good. Thank you for your mercy and your kindness. Thank you, Lord, for your love for us. Thank you, Lord, for your word. But we can anchor, Lord, our lives around your word, Lord, in your word. Thank you for the hope that we receive from your word. Lord, minister to us. Encourage those who are here who feel discouraged, maybe weighted down. Maybe there's things that are just maybe grabbing control of them. And maybe, Lord, I ask that you would help them to have a perspective shift if need be, that they would Lord, experience a fresh touch from you. Lord, a fresh touch from you to give them the encouragement to hope and the hope to keep on keeping on, for better days are yet ahead in glory. In Jesus' name, amen.